I will say that I don't think anything beats the 2 weeks in Minnesota where it never got above zero. Or the time in Colorado in March where we, Denver, we got 4 feet of snow. But anyway, before I get started, I'm going to act, I guess, a little bit as a lost and found. I found a couple of Charlie cards outside. I don't know if anybody is missing theirs.
On the back.
On the back, I've got the initials BS. I don't know if that's initials or somebody's commentary. I got a couple of Charlie cards here for somebody. My name is Steve Perry. I'm the chair of this year's events committee, and we're thrilled to have you here. Obviously, we had to reschedule the last one, and we appreciate you folks for coming to. I think will be one of our best events of the year, certainly on a very hot subject. That's for sure. So, for those of you who want to look at upcoming events, particularly once we get through the snow season, which should be, I guess, by mid-May, you can always go to HBSAB.org. And I just wanted to tell you about a few events subject to weather. We're once again going to run the new venture program. We have finished in the global competition first, second, and second over the last 3 years, so we've got a pretty good run going. The deadline for entry into that is this Sunday. It's a $10,000 first prize and an entry into the global program where I believe first prize is either $50,000 or $75,000. And I believe we're something like about 15 to 18 teams already, so that's great. The final four will be held here on March 19th. Actually, it's going to be at the Innovation Center for IBM over in Cambridge. And it will be a reception with beer and wine, okay? So that's good to know. We've got a really big event coming up on March 5th, and it's on the business of aging. We've got executives coming in really globally from P&G, CVS, Bank of America. Linda Hill, HBS professor, will be present as well. That's going to be a little longer, run from about 5 to 9, but absolutely an event not to miss. Okay, so that's going to be March 5th, and I'm assured it will not snow that night. We'll also be having some Crimson dinners, and that and the Town dinners, which will be scheduled in March and April to check the listings for that. And then also an event February 26th at the Harvard Club. Rick Williams will be moderating a panel discussion entitled How Companies Succeed and Why Many Don't. Of course, none of those will involve any HBS graduates, at least on the why many don't. You can laugh at that one. That wasn't that bad. And then our seventh annual CEO roundtable is going to be on April 1st. Now, that's true. It'll be on April 1st. Okay, so I'm not pulling anything. But that'll be a fun one. Okay. Events like this do not run without sponsors. And we've got three platinum sponsors. We've got the Sharmer Group. I believe is Stuart here tonight. Stuart Burson from the Wealth Management Group of Sharmer. Grant Thornton, I believe we've got Ben and, what, dozens here. So thank you very much for Grant Thornton. Appreciate it. And then, of course, Chris Keefe and his group with Nixon Peabody. So thanks again, Chris. This event is a little bit special for me. I've got kind of a personal connection. So bear with me just a little bit. I grew up in Chelmsford, about 25 miles northwest of here, and I've got a little bit of a personal connection with some of the panels. First of all, we have Phil Hall, although I used to know him better as Billy Hall, when he was the best friend of my youngest brother attending South Row Elementary School. And Billy, hopefully, or Bill, you don't take any of the things I said seriously. I'm a little Jerry Leon. Jerry was the former district attorney of Middlesex County, and in that role prosecuted many friends and family members. However, I see prosecuted, not too many convictions. But anyway, our moderators, I want to thank Kevin Morgan from Grant Thornton and Chris Keefe from Nixon and Peabody. And take it away.
Thanks, everyone, for being here this evening. I was going to address the pernicious, tenacious, growing threat that we all faced here, but Steve did all the snow news, so we'll move on. But we have an amazing panel assembled this evening, some luminaries from the field who I think will serve to give us a great overview of what's the history of sort of the threat matrix in the cybersecurity space, some recent issues that you've seen no doubt in the media, but maybe even some color of some that haven't gotten as much media play, and then some more practical, hopefully practical and takeaway lessons on how to help insulate yourselves and your organizations from some of the growing threats that we face. And so our format tonight, we'll introduce our panelists to you, and then each of the panelists has a bit of a slide deck to go through to give you some color from their standpoint, their respective topics. And then as quickly as we can, we want to open up because the best kind of discussions at these types of events happen when the field is broad. You're not sort of listening to talking heads up on the stage.
So, Kevin, you want to take it away? Great, thanks so much, and really appreciate it. My name's Kevin Morgan. I'm with Grant Thornton. I run our national cybersecurity practice. I co-lead that with some of my forensic colleagues, Skip Westfall. And as a lot of people have talked about, this is an absolutely critical topic. And so we take this all very seriously. And one of the things I just wanted to point out is, thanks to all the people that are already in this field helping protect us, law enforcement, technology vendors, service providers, and many of the folks that are here today, I think are really doing a wonderful job trying to protect us from these cybersecurity threats. And so my thanks to all of them, the panelists, and what they're doing to actually make things better, protect our financial systems, credit card information, personal information, health information. You know, they've got a great group tonight to really talk about some of those items and where you're at. And then really, if you look at the privacy and the data supply chain, and you really look at clients and companies, they really need to take this very seriously. And so things like very basic incident response plans, you know, we joke about the password things that we've seen, but this is becoming so important for us as a society. And as you look at that, what is really going on, not only with your own information, but also the extended ecosystem. I think that's a critical thing as you look at it in terms of that. And so with that, I just want to introduce a couple of our speakers. I'll start Mike Key, Senior Vice President, Rapid7. Tremendous technology background, no systems. You know, we were chatting a little bit earlier today. He was on with three different clients today. He's going to tell you a little bit about that. And really how long and what goes on in some of these areas. And getting to know and understand these threats that are sometimes there. And all the time hear about clients asking us, you know, have we been compromised? How do we know? What are we doing? And then also Bill Ho, this comp, and I just want to say thanks to both of them for what they're doing to help us from a technology perspective. Chris, back to you for the rest of the
evening. Thank you. As Steve mentioned, I'm Christopher Keefe. I'm a partner in corporate practice at Nixon Peabody LLP. We're a law firm with about 750 lawyers over 16 cities. I'm our deputy practice group leader for our corporate M&A transactions group. And I head the firm's big data initiative. So cybersecurity is near and dear to my heart because using these wonderful tools we have in terms of big data and analytics to create
stand up. I graduated from business school here in 1999, and how many people here? I just saw a bunch of people. They didn't went to business school here? The crippling school. Professors are always walking around and up and down the aisles, so I sort of feel, you know, now I'm down here, I get to do something along those lines. So thank you very much for the folks who pulled this together and for including us. I'm not the expert, I'm actually filling in for the expert. Our CEO, Corey Thomas, couldn't make it. One of the things I'll talk about later is government regulations have a lot to do with cybersecurity and continuing to lobby the government to be sharing information and laws in place where information gets shared. It's very, very important, and he got pulled in the last minute meeting on that front. So I'm filling in. Fortunately, I have Josh Feinblum. If you remember at HBS, there were cold calls, so I can maybe cold call Josh Feinblum, who's the VP of Security at Rapid7, here if there's any tough technical questions. Just briefly, Rapid7 is about a 500-person company. We do three things. Firstly, around threat exposure management. So basically try to tell companies where they're vulnerable and which of their vulnerabilities they should be concerned about. Second thing we do is incident detection and response. When bad things happen or when users get their credentials compromised, we have tools out there that help companies figure out this weird behavior or compromised credentials out there. And then one thing we've recently added to that is services, in that there's lots of noise, there's lots of questions, and lots of data, there's lots of tools, and there's a lot of people out there who are just saying, hey, where do I start? What should I do? So on that front, I'm kind of curious, by show of hands here, one of three categories: here because you help protect people from cyber crime and bad things that happen, you're looking for protection, or you're just generally interested. How many people are in the protection, looking to be protected? General interest. Okay. I'll tell some stories as we go through that. So, poor target. Not only did the CEO lose his job and the CIO off the job, but in every security company presentation, there's the play on the word target. And it keeps coming out, and we're a target for cyber criminals and stuff like that. But many people feel, in some respects, that put cybersecurity into the boardroom and onto the agendas of executives everywhere. And as I alluded to earlier, I was with a company today in insurance. I was with a company today in industrial manufacturing, and a company in media. And two of those three companies now have to answer to the board around their cybersecurity posture. A company that everyone knows around here, Dunkin' Brands or Dunkin' Donuts. I was speaking with their CIO, Jack Clare, relatively recently, and cybersecurity used to be kind of number 9 or 10 or whatever. Now he has weekly meetings, this is after the target breach, with the CEO going over their cybersecurity posture. So it's something that's much more prevalent, and it's no longer the smart guys like Josh out there and all these technical tools. People actually have to be able to answer to the business leaders how are they doing in terms of their overall cybersecurity posture. And what's happened is there's been an expansion of bad guys. I mean, it used to be the hackers that are in the basement, plugging away, doing it for fun, and now all of a sudden there's state-sponsored attacks, there's insider threats, we'll get in the inside, and there's a lot of money to be made. So before I go on the money you made, like I said, one of the things we do is help companies understand how vulnerable they are. So we have penetration testers, or white hats, as they're called, as opposed to black hats. Black hats being the activists or the insider threats. We have white hats. And just to give you a sense of how easy it is, we went down and did a penetration test with a large state government. And within one day, we had every driver's license in the state. We had the confidential informant database. I'm sure those of you in the law enforcement realize that's really real. When people go into the witness protection program, they actually don't want all that information to come out. We didn't have the social security numbers like they did in Athena Health, but we had all this information today, and we got in 3 or 4 different ways. So we went in there, and we took control of the video cameras. People don't think that the video server is as important as the server with all the financial information. Well, it turns out they control the video cameras, and you can actually manipulate the video cameras, and you can see people typing in their username and password. And then you have that username and password, and you go into the network, and you start promoting yourself to admin privileges on different servers, you get all the information. People talk about phishing or spear phishing. So not that hard going to LinkedIn. We went down, we found out who the head of HR is, human resources, and we put together a little email saying, hey, benefits time, we want you to sign up, we want to do a little bit of a survey on, did you like your benefits before, collect that information so we can offer you great benefits next year. 12 of the 60 people that we sent that to, username and password. We put a page in front of multifunction printers, saying, oh, you want to use a color printer, you want to print something out, just type your username and password. So once again, within a day, multiple different ways, we're the good guys. We're helping the state government in this situation understand where they're vulnerable, understand where they need to focus their efforts. But there's a lot of people out there with a lot of bad intentions that are doing exactly the same thing. And what's interesting is, and what's fueled this a lot, is as you keep seeing here, the cyber crime economy, in that there's good money out there. In the same way that Peabody has created a very liquid economy for used goods and Ticketmaster and sporting good tickets, there's a really liquid market out there where people can unload credit card numbers, email accounts, social security numbers, personally identifiable information. So it's a business now. So not only are there activists, state-sponsored, bad insiders looking for corporate espionage, corporate information, but it's a big business. What else has led to it? So, you know, it used to be the case of build a big wall. Have your corporate network, make sure you have your firewall, make sure you have antivirus. As long as we have a big wall, we're all set. Well, then the world started to get a little bit mobile, and people started accessing the corporate network from their laptops. But now more and more, a lot of the research that we do in terms of where the vulnerabilities are, it's almost all in those endpoints, not inside the corporate servers, inside the corporate wall. In terms of mobile phones, iPhones, iPads, you know, the average number of devices people have is 1.7. A lot of those devices are accessing very critical information, and they're accessing from the outside. So once again, now you have nice big walls around corporate headquarters, but it doesn't matter because people are accessing from their laptops, they're accessing mobile devices, and then they're accessing applications in the cloud. So companies' core applications, whether it's running their financial system, whether it's running their sales, customer relationship management tool, whether it's running their marketing solution, those are now on the cloud. So this idea of a corporate network, putting walls around that corporate network, is sort of ridiculous. Because everyone's accessing applications from devices outside the corporate network, to applications that are hosted outside the corporate network, and increasingly there's lots of partners that are trusted, that are involved in global business supply chains, that are involved in going to market. And then once again, not only you have to deal with all of your ecosystem, but you gotta be inspecting all of your partners. So once again, along the lines of all the tools that are out there before, there's firewall, there's intrusion detection system, intrusion protection system, SIM, which is security information and event management. All great stuff, great tools, but the problem is, you can spend millions and millions and millions of dollars, but if I get one username and password, I'm in. And obviously there's lots of things that you can do to segregate your network, and your data within that network, and protect the people that get in and look for those people. But one of the things that I'll talk about later is there's a fundamental shift from this prevention to detection and investigation. And the days of build big wall, protect, yeah, you still need to do that, but if you don't think people are going to get in, and you don't have good tools to find out when they get in, who got in, and what they're doing, then you're going to be at risk. This stat here always blows me away. So you hear about all these big breaches, Anthem Health, New York Times, Target, Home Depot, etc. Mainly it's one of the big incident response players in the market. On assignments that they went in, where there were big breaches, where the red phone rings, they got to show up and they got to figure out who's in there. On average, the bad guy's been in there for 229 days. The next amazing stat is 67% of the companies that called them up found out that someone was inside their walls from an external party, like the FBI. And the FBI's like, hey, just so you know, there's a lot of data being exfiltrated, being sent to this servers in all along the way. Okay with that? They're like, whoa, no, that's a problem. Then they start researching it. Then they're like, wow, they've been there for 229 days. So the tools are much better now. The hackers are much more sophisticated, and what they do is they get in and they're quiet. This whole idea around advanced persistent threats. And they just stay there for a little while. Then they hop over to the next system. And that's okay, kind of with the password, grab their privileges. Then they hop to the next system. So they stay there for a long time, planted, hiding, just waiting for the opportunity to either take data out or get another password, or a high level password, or whatever it might be. A couple more slides, or last slide here. So, three general points, and once again, I encourage lots of Q&A after we've gone through this. Clearly, from a government perspective, and that's where our CEO, Corey, is right now, really making sure that we're active and that the criminals don't have places to hide is very important. Raising the focus and priority of security, like I said, it's three customers I was at today. Well, actually, another example of a customer I was at a couple weeks ago was associated with Sony. Sony was a partner. This particular company I was at is one of the biggest publishers in the world. They have no security. They used to be partners with Sony. Sony got hacked. And they're like, maybe we should have a security policy. And like anything, if there isn't buy-in from the top, and there isn't a realization that this is important and something needs to be done, then it's going to be very, very hard to change things as much as necessary. And then finally, like I said, the bad guys are getting in. It's going to happen. There's no doubt about it. And the key is to have detection and investigation tools. So, like I said, you find out there's some strange behavior. You can dig down and understand what the genesis of that strange behavior is, and then you can react accordingly. So, with that, I'll turn it over to Bill.
Bill.
Yeah.
I've actually been in this position myself, like many of you have, and it's really not very hard to imagine that you get an email, it looks legitimate, it says something on there that strikes a chord, and you think, oh, I'm just going to click this link, I can see the reply, the URL looks good, and then it has an attachment that brings you to a site where it asks you to enter your username and password, and then you've got it. And it's surprisingly effective because people, I think these days, are obviously a lot more aware, but you know, they've used this technique over and over and over again, and there are always people who fall for it. And it is getting a lot more sophisticated. So I think everyone now knows not to give your bank account number or any money to a Nigerian prince, right? But just today, someone actually came up and he said, I got this Amazon order with that said I just bought an iPhone 6 and it's being shipped. And he said, I never bought this. And it had a Word document attached to it. Opened it up and it had virus. So, you know, it fools a lot of people, and even myself included. I have to watch out that I don't click on something. We've covered a lot of different hacks, breaches over the last year, and this is a graph I stole from Network World, and it just shows that, you know, the threat is out there. It's increasing, it's growing. Some really big ones too. Sony, of course, is something I thought actually a couple weeks ago we were going to talk about. And then Anthem comes out with 80 million potential record breach. But I think that one thing that's really interesting to me about the breaches that are happening is it's not just the credit card information. It's not just identity theft. And I know that was, again, a big talk before. But think about Sony. To me, that is actually a much worse, that event had huge repercussions because it didn't just expose, you know, some credit card information or PHI. It exposed email. emails and exposed, you know, information about what people are saying about each other. And, you know, in fact, even Pascal, I think, just fired from her job. But I sure wouldn't want any of those emails out there in the public. And, you know, I often think when I'm writing an email, do I want this email to be on the front page of the New York Times? If I don't, I'm not going to write it. Right, I'm going to make a call and tell that person before they're not recording it. So, you know, I think that's a much bigger concern these days than just the PHI that could be breached. So that's something I would be much more concerned about. And it leads me to kind of the general thinking, what is it that, you know, we want to protect ourselves from? I've been to a lot of security conferences, and one thing that we hear over and over again, or I do, is nothing is unhackable. So, as Mike said, it's out there, they're out there, they're going to get in if they want to, and the question is, what are you doing to protect yourself? And there's so many things that you can do. There are great sites out there. NIST has a great list of information and subjects on how to protect your organization, not only trying to prevent it, but also a potential response plan. When an incident does happen, you know, who to organize and who to activate, and then how to kind of deal with it. One thing I also was reading recently was a lot of the infrastructure out there is also at risk. And there was a test done not too long ago where a nuclear power plant, a simulation was put out on the web. And with the ability to, with an API that you could go in and change the controls, right? So they put it out on the web, and within 15 to 20 minutes, they got people in there, they found it, they started playing around with it, they started changing values, which potentially, you know, relates to flipping a switch or moving a needle, right? So you can imagine someone's playing with that control, increasing the pressure, and then they potentially have a catastrophic failure, right, in a nuclear power plant. So that's what actually really scares me. So I used a clubble back in the 90s. Did anyone else have this device? Yeah. It was a... I think, I was under the false impression that having this club was going to protect my car because they couldn't steer the thing, right? Clearly, it does need to do that, but there's a really easy way to hack this. And what these do is they cut the steering wheel, right? They can't cut through this hardened steel, but they can easily cut through the steering wheel, pull it out, and drive the car off. The reason this thing works, though, is that a thief is coming, walking by your car, he likes it, and he sees a club on it, and then right next to you is another car that doesn't have a club. He's not going to spend the extra 3 or 4 minutes to try to steal your car. He's going to go after the car that doesn't have that protection, right? So that was, I think, the real reason why the club existed. And in a similar vein, I'm terrible telling jokes, but so there are two campers who are... Walking down a trail, and they see a bear. The bear sees them too. It starts coming towards them. So one of the campers starts digging through his backpack and pulls out his running sneakers. And the other guy says, "What are you doing? You know we can't outrun a bear." Right? He says, "Well, I don't have to run a bear. I just have to outrun you." So that, you know, it's exactly the same theory behind people who do put protection around their or around a company. Even though we know that people can pretty much get into any company they want to if they really want that information back there. But if you're doing an opportunistic hack and you're just looking around and you see one company that has a lot of protection around it versus another that doesn't, I mean you're gonna go after the low hanging fruit. Right? It's a smash and grab. You're just going in trying to grab as much information as possible and you're getting out. This doesn't protect you from, I think, what actually Mike mentioned, which is APT, waiting very patiently to see what's going on, to see where it can move and what systems it can affect. Right. So that's another type of attack that really isn't really protected with this method. So I think the big issue for me is there's so many different ways that for vectors that information can be pulled out of your company. And I love Venn diagrams because you always know that you need to be in the middle right there of all these. And so looking at the cybersecurity threat out there, I mean, the areas that I see are the people is actually probably one of the most important aspects of this. And you really want to see if you can build a culture of security within the organization. It's education, right? It's policies. It's people just not even realizing that you want to make sure people don't go up to a copier and when there's a piece of paper that says enter your username and password, that they should know that that is not something they should be doing. Process is another big piece of the pie. This is where you really want to understand what in place. What happened when there is an incident, who do you activate. There's a formula that's out there, it's a risk formula, and they look at, what are your assets in your company that you have, your information assets, what are your potential vulnerabilities, and then what are the threats out there. And that product is what a lot of people look at as their risk factor. And the last piece is technology. And this is actually one thing that a lot of people like to talk about because it's so tangible. People love the fact that they can put a piece of hardware or software in their network and they feel like they're being protected. It's definitely good to have that, but it's also in some ways a false sense of security because there are so many ways to get in. You may be protecting one area, but your front door is barricaded and locked, but your back door is left open. There's just a lot to think about. Thank you.
When Chris told you about my background, he alluded to the fact I spent 20 years in government. The last 15 years, I was the elected district attorney in Middlesex County. Prior to that, I ran the terrorism program right after September 11th as the first assistant U.S. attorney. And before that, I ran the criminal bureau with the AG's office. I was the chief of the criminal bureau. So forgive me when I talk about these issues around cyber security and data privacy as crisis risk management, because what I've done the last 15 years is crisis risk management. When I looked at the president's February 13 executive order and then looked at through and digested the February of 2014 NIST framework document, risk management is all over both his executive order and the NIST framework. So it was nice to be in good company when I talk about these issues in terms of a crisis risk management, where the president continues to harp on these issues as being just that. He also continues to harp on the issues of public-private partnerships, which I hope to talk about and develop a little more with my colleagues here, because frankly, I think it's the most important thing that we can do as a country to keep ourselves safe around these issues. As I look around the room, I know some people here, I don't know a lot of you, but I can tell you this, we're all crisis risk managers. We're held accountable, we're held responsible within our organizations. And the standard I use when I talk about crisis risk managers, it's not the person who can put the fires out, and that's real important, but you've probably heard this adage, it's the person who can stop the fires from starting to begin with. That's who's really valuable to me. And that's how I look at all of these issues around cybersecurity and data privacy. It's that front end, okay? It's the front end focus, prevention, preemption, prophylactic measures that you can take so that you don't get into a situation where you're on the back end. And I'll talk a little bit about that as well. To pick up on something Mike said earlier, Eddie Davis and I go to the National Association of Corporate Directors meetings, and the last two we were at where they talked about cyber, and the third, which is coming up on March 10th, I can tell you, as Mike alluded to earlier, this is an enterprise-wide risk issue. This is no longer just the IT guys' issue. This is the board of directors, and it's the C-suite, and they are being held on a governance level and an oversight level to be responsible for these cyber issues. It's at the highest levels. So it couldn't be clearer, just to knock on what Mike alluded to earlier. When I talk about the front end, the prevention side, you got to forgive me, because having been in government 20 years, I talk in acronyms all the time and alliteration, but it helps me remember things. I talk about the P's. A lot of people refer to these in a lot of different ways, whether it's practices, policies, procedures, programs. It doesn't matter what you call it, but if it's one of the P's, you've got to have it right. And this is such a fluid area these days that you really have to be on top of all of the developments, because it is such a fluid area. I'd like to talk to you about a few things that I think you should be considering on the front end to protect your organization in the area of cybersecurity and data privacy. The first, and it doesn't matter what you call it, some people call it threat assessment teams, some people call them cyber attack rapid response teams. But the concept is this: you have to have, internally, you have to have a top-to-bottom and cross-silo approach to these type of teams. And the four critical components are IT, security, HR, and legal. Those four departments and the people who run those departments have to be at the table. Now, there may be some members of an executive and admin within your corporation, but those four silos have to be represented, and they've got to be talking to each other. I talked to a good friend who's a general counsel of an international company recently, and after we got through talking about these issues, he said, Jerry, no, of course he's in charge of the legal department. He said, Jerry, the other members in the room today sometimes won't tell me my pants are on fire. You can't have that around these cybersecurity issues. You've got to have cross-silo communications. That's the internal component of these teams. There's also an external component to these teams, and this is another one of the dichotomies you'll hear me go in and out of. External relationships are critical. Now, you can make a determination by assessing your own organization whether you have these abilities and capabilities internally, but these are the type of relationships you need to have externally. Forensic technical expertise. You may have it internally, but you need someone outside. You need a relationship with somebody outside your organization. Law enforcement agents, law enforcement officials, and law enforcement organizations. You've got to have a relationship with them. And you want that relationship before things go bad, not when the red flag goes up. Legal counsel. You may have in-house counsel, but attorney-client privilege issues get really complicated depending upon whether your in-house counsel is giving business and or legal advice. So you've got to consider whether or not in-house counsel is sufficient with regard to these issues. Because when the incident or breach happens, a lot of different government regulated requirements are going to kick in with regard to notifications. So these are the external members. These are the relationships you need to have on the outside. Now, some important developments that I want to mention to you, because I think even if these things formally aren't adopted, conceptually you need to think about what these things mean on the front end in taking a preventative approach to cybersecurity. The first, and you've heard this being referred to by Bill and Mike, is NIST and the cyber framework. Now, it doesn't have to be NIST. There are some other ones out there. I happen to like NIST. I think it's very good. Our president, through his executive order, has recommended that NIST be the framework that everybody should take a look at. It's voluntary, but like anything else in this business, if the bad thing happens, the incident or breach happens, and you haven't looked at, you haven't tried to favorably upon that. There are checklists. I can tell you, I spent 20 years in county, state, and federal government. When the bad thing happens and you're looking at the person who's now being held responsible and you go through your checklist and those boxes haven't been checked along the way, there isn't a lot of empathy or sympathy for you that things went bad. Okay. Public-private partnerships is a real takeaway from NIST. Eddie Davis and I have been talking about this September 11th when we got together and formed task forces around this state after what happened on that day. Public-private partnerships are critical. The president continues to push it from where he is on down. Insider threats. Mike alluded to this earlier. In September of this year, the Department of Defense issued a program. That program, for anybody who deals with defense contractors, is going to have to be put in place between now and December. Now, you don't have to work with or be a defense contractor to use the guidance within that document as an important framework for you. The takeaway there is what's talked about in the industry, the defense industry, is the whole person approach, and that is that you know your employees. You know information about your employees. And that way you can assess where there may be insider threats, be they malicious or otherwise. And that's why, again, I commend the insider threat program the Department of Defense has put out along with NIST as something that can help you build in preventative programs. The third-party vendors and suppliers. And you saw some, from some of the breaches that Bill had put up on his slide, third-party vendors, suppliers, that can be the portal in. You've got to make sure that you've done your due diligence on third parties, that you've imposed requirements. These should be written. They should be contractual between your organization and third parties that you're relying upon. Two other things. Risk assessment tools. You will talk to many vendors, many third-party partners now about this. I think it's a great idea, and it helps organizations engage in a cyber spend decision assessment. It's a combination of essentially three things. It's risk assessment metrics, it's experience, the people who've dealt with a breach and what it's going to require, along with attaching dollar signs and costs to that assessment and those metrics, so that when you need to be informed about what something's going to cost and you need to make your cyber spend, you're actually looking at some data that helps you put a dollar sign on it. And if you're running an organization, that's extremely important to be able to do. And more people are coming up with these tools. The last thing, and again, this is conceptually and things that you should consider on the front end, the recently proposed legislation by our president, you'll take a look at that. A lot of it won't pass. A lot of it has no chance of passing. However, conceptually, there are a lot of things in that proposed legislation which is important. The takeaway I have from having been a state, county, and federal prosecutor is this. There are some allusions within the legislation to what we always call the corporate charging factors, especially when I was a federal prosecutor. That's one of those check boxes which says, once you get in trouble, how many of those boxes have you checked on the front end? From a compliance and preventive standpoint. And if you haven't checked a lot of those boxes, when it goes bad, you're not going to be looked favorably upon by the government. Okay? That's the front end. Now, just quickly, the back end. Now, this is when the incident, the breach, the crisis occurs. Okay? And I can't stress enough, and again, I'll kick into the acronyms and the four C's. Okay, coordination, collaboration, cooperation, communication. You know, if real estate is about location, 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 okay, if you're on the back end, it's all about communications. And there's two parts to that, is internal and external. Okay? Internally, within your organization, there's got to be vertical communications top to bottom. Again, it's from the very top of the organization down through, and it's cross silos, especially those four very important ones. IT, HR, legal, and security. Okay. That's internal communications. Let me make two points about external communications. You may have this capacity and capability internally. If you don't, this is one of those areas where you have to go external. You need to know government regulators. Okay. In Massachusetts, you need to know the Attorney General's office. You need to know the U.S. Attorney's office. When I was a district attorney, attorney, the woman who was my right hand, sat right outside my door. And she would know when I was listening sometimes, and she would send a little message to me. And my name's Jerry Leone, okay? When I would hear her say, "No, sir, Jared Leon isn't here today," I would know that that's somebody I have never talked to. They probably don't really know what I do, but the red flag has gone up on their side, and they need me. My point is this. You want to know at least the office, if not the key government regulators, who are going to be on the government end of a breach, looking for you to make the right notifications, right? Because if the first time you're meeting them is when the red flag goes up, you're a step behind. So if you have the capability inside, that's fine. If you don't, you should look for that externally. Somebody who knows not only the laws and the rules and the regs, but knows the offices that you're going to have to deal with. The other thing on the external communication, and we know this in the year 2015, the media. If you don't have internal capacity or capability, if you don't have somebody who understands about public communications, you need to get somebody. Whether you're in a small company or a big company, it doesn't matter, it's your breach. And as we know, there are competitors all over the place out there. And you will be compromised, not just by what has happened by way of the incident or breach, but what your competitors will do and what the media will do these days with a breach. So again, these are two areas that I would suggest having relationships with outside of your organization. These are just some takeaways, and I've dealt with media for a long time. Ed and I have compared notes for several years. I've happened to have been in some positions where they were high-profile offices, so you had to deal with the media. How many of you have ever heard the word holding statement? Do you know what that is? What a holding statement is? Okay. This is what a holding statement is. If something's about to go bad or it goes bad, you want that team I talked about in place, and you want the most self-serving promotional statement that you can put together by your team in the event that you need to use it. This is a great exercise, even if you don't have to use it. But you've got to get used to talking internally and knowing how you're going to communicate, because you've got stakeholders out there, internally and externally, depending upon the nature of your company, especially if you're a public-facing company. Get used to communicating like that and knowing that you may have to communicate with the public. Information, if you don't know the nature, scope, and extent of the breach, don't say anything publicly. You know, I can tell you, some of the people that are getting fired now, it isn't even because of the incident or the breach. It's because what they said or didn't say publicly, which absolutely put their organization in a very bad light and just croaked them publicly. Off the record, that is a very important concept. If you don't know media and have never engaged in an off-the-record conversation, get somebody who has and have them in the wings. Because you can control, or you can at least alter what that public communication is by the media by having effective off-the-record communications. And you know, I can tell you, Ed and I have engaged in plenty of these over the course of our career. Sometimes it turns out the way you'd really like it to, sometimes it doesn't, but at least you want to have the opportunity to engage in that type of communication. Okay. There are other things on the slide which, you know, I've learned over the years, but you've got to be prepared on the online side. Try to figure out where that story's going and who's writing it and who's trying to compromise you publicly. This is a very important component of what you do on the front end in the year 2015. Finally, this is something that both Mike and Bill have touched upon and that Ed will go into in detail, but you know, if I had to say, you know, here's a quick list of the things that you absolutely have to do. If we have a should do, could do, need to do list, this is it. I think we'll talk some more about these items as we go along. I'll pass the baton to my pal, Ed Davis, now.
Thanks, Chair. Hello, everybody.
Hello.
The great part about going last is everybody has pretty much said everything that needs to be said. So I will very quickly go through these slides and try to give you some insight from my perspective. You know, I did not set out to get into the cyber business. I did not set out, as a matter of fact, if someone told, someone that knows me said that I was was talking about cyber, they'd start laughing. You know? I'm not a bits and bytes guy. I'm not a guy that knows much about firewalls. But I do know emerging threats. And because of what Jerry and I have done for all of our careers, we understand that to really address this emerging threat requires a process. And we're familiar with that process, okay? And let me go back to some of the things that I've done in my career as a police commissioner. First of all, I know the media. You know, like Bill Belichick, who has a sports department in the Boston Globe, I have a crime department in the Boston Globe, right? Which means that every morning I've got one, maybe three reporters calling from the Boston Globe, asking me different questions about crime that occurred, or the latest scandal, or the latest thing that we're dealing with in the business, right? So Jerry and I have been doing that for a long time, and we know the process to follow when there is a crisis about to occur or that has occurred. And I have an enormous amount of experience with dealing with major events. And I don't mean the marathon. Let's talk about when President Obama visits Harvard University or comes into the city of Boston for a fundraising event. I'm called into a room with the Secret Service and his staff a week beforehand, and the itinerary is laid out, and the Secret Service will tell you, we cannot protect the president without several hundred Boston police officers. And that happens frequently. I covered at least five of those visits with President Clinton and President Obama. And there's a process that we follow when we do big events like a presidential visit. And that process starts off with understanding the threat picture, putting together intelligence to understand what we will be facing or may be facing with this particular challenge that we have. And I will tell you that in the world of cyber, the threat picture involves all of the technical things that we spoke about here. Bill and Mike had outlined the breaches that have occurred, and you've all read about them in the paper. But 60% of successful breaches are due to human failures. And so we have a technical problem that needs firewalls and technical solutions, but we also have a human problem. And dealing with that human problem and dealing with the threat picture and that matrix that you have to take a look at, putting solutions against those threats, and then examining what you do continually and practicing is what makes an effective response. I don't have to go into phishing and spear phishing, except to say, when you go back to your offices in the various places that you work, just take a walk through some of the places and flip the keyboard over and see how many passwords are taped to the bottom of the keyboard. Just take a look at that. In the Sony hack, they found a file in the corporate headquarters that said passwords. And you know, I make a reference to the Bunko Squad because I go back that far. I know what that means. Maybe you don't know what that means. But Bunko was a game of fraud that occurred on the streets of New York, and they created a squad of police to go out and tip those games over and make sure that they weren't stealing money from people. Right. The truth of the matter is, the Kenyan Prince story. I've got my own take on that. 10-15 years ago, I'm sitting at my desk in Lowell, and a leading political figure calls me on the phone and says to me, "Chief, I have a very serious problem here with this new computer I've got." And I said, "What's that?" He said, "A Kenyan prince has $7 million U.S., and if I send him $5,000, he will send that $7 million to me. What is going on here?" And I thought to myself, Bunko knows what's going on there. You should know. Don't answer the email, right? So we've gone from those kind of funny, simplistic kind of things that occurred 10 or 15 years ago to very complex and changing environments now. And we need to guard against those. We need to do all that we can to make sure that the cyber threat does not spill over into the real world and affect you. What, the first class I took on cyber at the FBI Academy, I was told very clearly there's a cyber world and there's a real world. And you can commit crimes in the real world and you can also commit crimes in the cyber world. And that's absolutely true. But that delineation does not exist anymore. You all know about the Stuxnet virus that was sent out ostensibly by our government, maybe, right, to affect the centrifuges in Iran. That virus has now gone to other places. But it was the first time that I heard that there was that crossover from the cyber world to a piece of machinery. In 2007, DHS did something called Operation Aurora, where they set up their own generator, connected it to the internet, and hacked it. I've had over the last year, I've worked with Motorola and Deloitte on some international telecommunications projects. And I've had direct contact and worked very closely with people that actually invented something called a SCADA technology. SCADA technology is a way the utilities control some of their vital pieces of equipment. And the ability to hack SCADA is a major issue right now. These guys that hacked this generator back in 2007 were able to go in with a very simple program of turning it on and off, were able to self-destruct that generator by controlling it through the internet. This is frightening stuff. It relates to the Internet of Things, which is where we're at right now. So when your car can be controlled from outside the car, when I have a lock on my door that's controlled by my smartphone, I am opening up the Internet of Things to the cyber threat. And we need to be able to address that at a corporate level and at a personal level. We have to be prepared. Now, when we responded to the Marathon bombings, we had an incredible response from the medical community. The medical community came in and saved the day. There were over 200 people that were injured in those two separate bombings. 47 of them were critical patients that left the scene. Of those 47 that left the scene, not one died. Everyone survived. Doctors were doing multiple amputations at Mass General who had just finished running the race. They continued to run to Mass General to do the work that they had to do. The medical response was spectacular. It happened because 2 years before that, we had all worked together. Across those channels, those silos of responsibility, police, fire, EMS, people from the emergency rooms came together and they practiced what would happen in a worst case scenario. We practiced a Mumbai-style attack here in the city of Boston. It was because we practiced that, because we put things, responses together, that we were able to effectively respond to the threat when it manifested itself. Effective crisis management relies on valid information. If there's one thing that Jerry and I know from working these crises, is that you do not go forward with a media response or any kind of public response until you know what you have. And the first few minutes of a crisis, everything you know will be wrong. So you need people at that table that are going to drill down, put boots on the ground, get out there and find out exactly what's occurring before you make any public statements that are going to embarrass you later on. We've known this because we've lived it. And the ability to get accurate and timely information when you're facing a crisis like this. You know, it's not a case of if, it's a case of when. You don't want the FBI coming in the door and telling you that they've been in your systems for the last 200 days. And I'll just say briefly that this Amy Pascal is not a very nice person anymore. I mean, I don't know how you say those things in a corporate environment and get away with it. You don't get fired until after you get caught, you know. But anybody that's making fun of the president and talking about their highest performers in the terms that she was doing that sort of ended up getting her just desserts. Let me just talk talk about the importance of that, though. Understand that they are into everything that you have. I did a contract here for a client that I can't identify, but they had a flat system. So if somebody get into their system at the point of the auditing or the accounting, or through one of their clients, or through like in Target, the HBAC attack, they could run across the whole system. It wasn't segmented. So they could go right into their manufacturing facility and shut down their manufacturing capacity. So that company, after we went in and talked to them, is segmenting their computers. But you need more than that. I've gone into companies, and I've been doing a lot of physical assessment, physical security assessments. And inevitably, I went to the company, do the physical assessment, and then the CEO will call me and he'll say, could you go downstairs and talk to my IT guys? They're always complaining. They always want more money. And I go down there and I talk to the IT guys, and inevitably, in almost every company I've been in where I've had this conversation, they are in the bowels of the building, and they've got these tennis rackets, and they're batting away hand grenades every day, right? How many times were you attacked today? Oh, we got 100 that we shut down. We got 150 we shut down. And they don't listen to me up there. Nobody will buy the things that I know that we need to buy. And so we need right now for And it's happening. It's happening because of the regulatory environment, because of what the president's been saying, because of breaches at Target. There is a change, a significant change in this. The boards and the CEOs are paying close attention to it. But we really need to activate a larger response, because this is a really serious violation of our personal space and our financial future and our corporation's ability to survive. Sony was a game changer. They didn't just come in and steal money. They didn't just come in and steal something that they could sell. They actually, because of political motivations, I mean, there's still argument about who did this, but I think it was North Korea based upon the government statements. There was an attack that could have destroyed a large corporation. And that is chilling, to think that it can go that far. Michael Chertoff, who I was with a couple of weeks ago, never connect my door lock. He was mad at me for doing this. I'm still connected, but anyway. Debit cards. Let me just talk about John Carlin. I spoke with John, Assistant Attorney General for National Security. The first time in 50 years the United States Department of Justice has created a new division. It came out of the Patriot Act, but there is a division now that deals with terrorism, that deals with espionage, and it deals with cyber attacks. That's how important this government has assigned this threat picture. And Jerry and I have both dealt on a very personal level, him on the Richard Reed case, and me on the Sanaya case. We faced this threat of terrorism directly. But I can tell you that even though I had this very nice little practice going with telecommunications, I keep getting dragged back into the physical security. And after doing that for a little while, I get dragged right into cyber. It is inevitable that people are looking for help in this area. So I've recently teamed up with a company called RSA that does the bits and bytes. They have the expertise to do a comprehensive look at what's happening. But I submit to you today that because of the Internet of Things, we have moved beyond a firewall's mentality to this problem. This problem really, really relies on effective intelligence, clear and timely data, and an overall look at your assets so that they can be protected from a physical attack as well as a cyber attack. Thank you.
We have something, and this is not a separate commercial because there's lots of other engagements and services offerings like this, but we call it a cyber security maturity assessment, which is a bit of a mouthful. But we try to quantify 1 through 4. 5 scale, the maturity of an organization as it relates to security. And we take a look at their 20 core security controls, and we measure the maturity of those, once again, 1 through 5 scale. And at the end of it, you get a nice little spidergram that says, hey, you're a 2.0, and in your industry, we believe you should be a 3.5, and here are the particular controls that are most interesting. Because at the end of the day, at that level, typically what they want to know is, where do I need to get to? And where am I now? Where do I need to get to? And what are the steps to get there? And then am I moving in the right direction or wrong direction? So I think it's a very good hygiene effort for organizations to take that baseline look at how their overall security condition is.
We actually just promoted someone within our organization to become the CISO of our company, and it's because it's such an important aspect of what we do. We're actually a company that produces software that allows you to securely deliver documents and files and messages. And you know, so from our perspective, we actually use tools that are similar to what Rapid7 has to understand the penetration of our products. But at the same time, we're also a company out there that has to deal with, as Ed said, you know, people who are attacking us all the time. You put a new server out there, and within minutes, you've got people scanning your ports, trying to figure out if you have any unpatched servers. So it's a constant battle. And I think these days, the C-suite definitely, and the board, are all involved in understanding it. And I think that's happening very quickly these days, just because of all the breaches. I used to blog about breaches a lot, you know, maybe 10 years ago. It just got tired. And now, I couldn't even imagine doing it, because every day there's something new.
Great. So we heard the term NIST discussed a couple of times, and I'd like to just, for the audience, define that a little bit. Jerry, if you can, talk a little bit about that and what that's about.
How many of you are familiar with NIST? Oh, okay. So, National Institute of Standards and Technology. Just real quickly, information sharing directives to three different persons who run that stage of our government: the Attorney General, the Secretary of Homeland Security, and the National Intelligence Director. And NIST was created because of the executive order of the President in February of 2013. It focuses on public-private partnerships. It focuses on critical infrastructure. I can tell you, you know, we've come a long way, but, and Ed's going to remember this, when I was running the terrorism program here, right after September 11th, we were talking about this stuff. This was a focus of what we were doing back then. So to be this many years later and still be talking about our critical infrastructure and public-private partnerships is a little off-putting. But I can tell you, NIST is a very good framework. A lot of you put your hands up, so I don't have to go into it as much as I otherwise might. But it's, you know, identify, protect, detect, respond, and recover. And it covers all different types of actions that your organizations should be engaged in order to maximize your ability to be safe and secure on your cyber systems.
Speaking of putting hands up, we'd love to entertain any questions from the audience.
Thank you. I have a question probably directed for Ed Davis. The conversation has been directed a lot to C-suite protection of corporations. I'm interested in cities. I know that cities are just discovering and moving rapidly into the digital age, and they've got data on police reports, they've got data on inspectional services calls and pulling building permits, they've got data on kids and buses and all kinds of things. What are the security protections that Mr. Leone outlined for a C-suite organization that you're seeing happen at the municipal level?
I was thrust into this with the Occupy movement. We made, I don't know if you remember that. Actually, it was a big crisis at the time. It seems so sweet now. It was no big deal. But we were targeted by Anonymous and a whole group of hackers, and they basically they got some information from one of our union computers, which wasn't protected, and they were able to publish, like, my chief of department, they put his mother's address on the internet, so people went to her house and harassed her. You know, it's sort of like, it was an education for us, because I had a computer that did community outreach. It didn't get into any of our systems, which were highly protected by a very sophisticated process that they were never able to hack into. But some of our ancillary servers that did outreach did get hacked, and one of them was this, it's called a citizens outreach computer, where we were putting, you know, how many burglaries occurred in a neighborhood. You could access that and figure out what was happening around your house. They got into that. It had no identifying information, but it had totals and data. And when I looked at it, it was being hosted off-site by another company. So I tried to make, when we had the crisis meeting with all of the lawyers and the media people, I tried to say, well, look, this really wasn't a hack of the Boston Police Department. It was a hack of this company that works. And my media person said to me, forget it. It's yours. You won't win. Okay? And she was right. She was absolutely right. So we crafted a response that was appropriate to the threat. I'll tell you this. The really important information, the informant information, information around suspects, rape information, things like that, is highly protected. Now, that's not to say that it can't be hacked. I know it can be hacked. And you know, I went to an FBI briefing not too long ago where they have these cameras now that you can buy publicly that you can put across the street from an ATM, and they can get your code from across the street. And if they can do that on an ATM, they can do that on your computer at your desk. And so when the cleaning people come in later that night, they can get into your systems because someone has taken a picture of you keying in that information. There's 1,000 different ways that these systems can be hacked into. And, you know, we've done all that stuff over the years, you know, kind of doing undercover operations and figuring out how to get into places when we were chasing organized crime people and terrorists. I've stolen cars and broken into apartments, all under court order, by the way. But I've actually done that. And you put yourself, like Mike is doing that right now, the white hats are in the shoes of the bad guys, and they are disclosing the vulnerabilities. It's out there. It's just, you know, you have to identify the crown jewels. You have to look at the threat picture and the work that Mike does that. You can come in and look at who's attacking you, what kind of malware is right now on your servers, because it's there in a lot of cases. And then you can try to, and then you can devise a plan to properly deal with it, and that's what we do.
Might I just add, just from the municipal perspective, you probably know this, but on the legal front, 201 CMR, Code of Mass Regs, and Mass General Laws 93H. That's what you've got to know as it relates to, this goes for non-municipalities too, but those are the two pieces of law you have to start with in this state as it relates to what your front-end obligations are and what your back-end obligations will be if you do suffer a breach.
I just want to make a point of clarification. NIST is housed in the Department of Commerce.
Right.
And has been around for quite a while. The controls that you'd be interested in are the 853 version 4 controls. And you should probably want to look at how to do a risk assessment. All of these are free, downloadable from the NIST site.
And the 853 was also includes a reference to that inside a threats Department of Defense inside a threats program that I mentioned earlier, so thank you for mentioning that.
I think that's the cybersecurity framework that you're talking about.
Oh, yeah.
That was written in 2013. So, yeah, they're two separate things. Because they are the National Institute of Standards and Technology, they have the controls very well codified, and they're available to the public to download.
Requiring lean of the Watchman Group had a very interesting prediction that makes these statements every year and ideas. One was that a major money center bank would be hacked this year. It's going to cause a financial crisis. So, is that something you believe? And if so, how do we prepare for that?
Can you get that from a movie? Well, I think it's happening. it just amazes me just how it all works. It seems to work so well. And I'm curious as just how resilient it is to an attack or to someone trying to inject some kind of malware or that would game the system. There was an event not that long ago with the trading system, right, where the really rapid transaction was a big bug in the software, right, and it shut down the trading system. So yeah, there is clearly I see that as a very big potential.
They spent a lot of money. I think JP Morgan, where they got breached, their budget's around $500 million a year, which is just astronomical. And we've dealt with some of these banks ourselves, and this one's very, very complicated. So there's certainly a risk, without a doubt, and a little bit to Jerry's point around the public-private partnership. The more they have industry associations that are sharing information, the more that they can happen better. So,
It's been said, or read, that retail has been the slowest to pick up on security measures, in part because they run on tight margins, maybe also in part because the credit card companies seem to be bearing the bulk of the burden, or maybe us in the end. Do you guys agree with that, I guess? And I'm wondering, if so, do you see it changing? Is it getting better as a result of targets, since targets was brought up a couple of times?
Well, I know some of the hacks for plug-in retail running point-of-sale systems, and there was a vulnerability within that they took advantage of. I don't know much about the amount of money that they're budgeting for this, but it seems like it definitely be something that is
okay. Right, so in retail, they have the payment card, PCI industry, and they have within that a thing called the report of compliance. And those actually standards have come out, and they're reinforcing some of that. One of the things that also probably goes highly unreported is the tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of attempts that those retailers are fighting off. Now, as we heard today, these things have gotten much more sophisticated, and clearly there's issues as you look at that. So, there is a cost to all of it, and you mentioned retailers and how they're doing with it, but it's clearly an industry that, is trying to address that. Now, with that said, that's an industry that is a tough business to be in, right? Thin margins, got to have a lot of the right stuff come all together. So I think that's something, though, if you look at that, they're doing it. And then, more importantly, the online aspect of that, right? Because so much of the commerce is now shifting from classic traditional stores, malls, and shopping to e-commerce. And so, that's a whole other area that they also have to protect and understand the vulnerabilities, as you could imagine. So again, the stakes have gone up now that everything's available online, through your own device.
So I did actually look up a stat on Target, and I'm not sure this is related to their breach, but they had a 46% drop in Q4 profit 2013. That was right after, that was while the breach was happening. And the other interesting stat I saw was the 40 million credit cards that were stolen, I think there's an assigned value around $20, $25 a card, that the people who stole that information, they made $53 million on this breach. And so, this is why I think it's, they're out there, organized crime. This is such an easy, way to make some money. And so you could find companies like Target and other vulnerable companies with infrastructure that's not protected. That's a lot of money.
I really worry about the medical field, especially the throes of the anthem.
Yeah, so I was going to say the same thing on the medical side. So retail, due to the payment card industry standards, have gotten a lot more stringent in the last year. There's been a lot more activity amongst those companies to get more secure. But the medical field scares me quite a bit in that you can change your credit card number, you can't change your social security number and your birth date and your name. And once that information gets out there, that's dangerous. And then in the med device fund, one of our hackers is diabetic, and he hacked his insulin pump.
Oh, wow.
So he was able to remotely affect or alter the dosage being given very, very big deal because you're working for a large technology services company that did a lot of business with this med device company. The med device company got fired from this other large technology services provider company. I mean, it's just hundreds of millions of dollars in terms of recalls. I mean, these are, you know, certainly not mainstream, but the point was made by a few people, specifically Ed at the end. I mean, this Internet of Things is just making that web of entries and the interconnectedness that much more concerning.
So there's actually a thread that's been written about on pacemakers that being able to hack a pacemaker is a possibility. So it really does extend into really frightening areas. But you really have to be armed with the proper information to be able to meet these threats. And, you know, I want to just say one thing about the organizations. Attorneys are very good at putting additional levels of security on their mobile devices. I've seen them use them when I work with them. Right? There's two-party verification. There are systems built in. But in the medical field, that doesn't happen. And I spoke to the head of one of the huge organizations here in the last year, trying to educate people in the medical field that those levels of security are vital to the ongoing safe storage of information is a challenge in that area. It's a challenge for journalists. I know that too. I do a lot of work in the journalism field. These guys want to get on a computer and go right in and get the information out. They don't want to, because time is money. Time is, you know, this news cycle, continuous news cycle. It kills them if they get delayed. But there has to be some discipline built into those professions because they are vulnerable.
So this isn't my field, so excuse my ignorance, but it seems to me that we're trading convenience for security. And I genuinely don't understand why a lot of companies don't just separate their network that contains sensitive information from their network that connects to the internet. So excuse my ignorance, but could you talk about whether an actual physical separation would address some of these issues? Because people are going to make mistakes. It's the nature of human beings. That's one question. And my second question is, as individuals, do you have recommendations as to what we can do to protect ourselves as much as we can?
I said earlier, no debit cards. I mean, there's a few things. I'm sorry?
Even for taking cash out of the, or just using it and putting it in the safe.
Yeah, debit cards, you don't get any protections. If you use credit cards, they protect the amount of money that can be taken. So if someone does hack into your account, you lose that money. It won't be protected except in some very, very, special arrangements that people have. But to your point, there are 4 billion smartphones sold every 2 years. There's 1.6 billion PCs that are sold every 5 years. If you look at that chart, the smartphones and the devices are far outstripping the computers that have more security on them. 6% of smartphones were the percentage in 2008. 6% of smartphones were the percentage of all consumer electronics. This year, it's 48%. By 2020, 80% of humans on the planet will have a smartphone by 2020. So I'm working on a project in Mexico right now. They've never built out a telephone infrastructure in many of the states. They don't have to. It's all cellular right now. And that's happening across the world. But that opens up an enormous challenge to us in trying to secure these devices. It'd be nice if we could separate them, but it's just not going to happen. For convenience sake, people want to get into their information, and it becomes a part of business practice. And it's I understand, you know, it doesn't seem right, but if you're a doctor in an emergency room and you need to know what medications that patient who just came in is on or are on, so that you don't kill them with new medications in an emergency procedure, that information becomes vital. So I don't know how it becomes part of everything that we do.
So you talked a lot about some low-level inquiry
sure that there isn't critical information on externally facing servers, and making sure the networks are very segregated, make sure there's encryption and information that flows across those networks. So best practices are being adopted. There's lots of promise. I'm not sure it's been delivered yet around big data and security. Certainly something that we're trying to do is leverage a lot of the data collection capabilities and intelligence that we can gather, and that highlights anomalous behavior in terms of you can see very quickly when someone's doing something that they don't normally do or going somewhere they don't normally go. So there are technology companies out there where I think they're doing a pretty good job in the cybersecurity space of taking the big data tools and allowing better to signal the noise ratio. There's lots of noise out there right now, but it's which of those alerts should you actually care about? So there's a lot of effort being made. Sure. It's not
it seems like it's an escalating benchmarking. People raise up their practices, hackers do something a little bit more sophisticated. At some point in time, you know, it's going to be more technology that's going to be the actual protector than what a person is going to do. Even though the practices
I'm going to actually look at Josh a little bit, who's very familiar with a lot of these tools that he put into Rapid 7. I don't know if you want to comment on some of the innovations in cybersecurity that you've seen that have been helpful.
I think I'll be blunt. It's a people issue at this point, right? I mean, the prime target of nearly every major breach starts with people and passwords. And your question is a matter of influence and fortitude, right? When you're talking about why companies don't silo networks and they tie together. Right, so internally, you have a problem which has historically been viewed as an IT problem when it's not. So the reality is you have a bunch of security people running around their IT shop saying, this is a big problem, and nobody listens. Right, so you have a people problem that converts into this very issue of educating your entire organization around what security is, how sophisticated some of these attacks look and work, and how they impact every single person in the business. So it's a much broader issue, and I think technology has its place and it helps, but it's not what solves the problem today.
But I think also there's a lag, right? So you get there's a threat that happens or an incident, and then something comes out to then protect you. So but that initial attack could be unavoidable. One thing I know that's out there, they're building a lot of, today's firewalls, their advanced firewalls are, they're all heuristic based, and they look at, they're just trying to understand, as Mike said, anomalies, right? So they look for spikes in bandwidth. They look at, ports that are being used that aren't normally open. And this, at least they can see, okay, am I getting a, being a, DOS attack, denial of service attack, or someone trying to infiltrate into my organization. So, but it's one of those things where you've got people who are really smart out there. They see the ROI is really high for these types of attacks, and so it's really hard. It's definitely a game of catch up. The other thing I'll just mention too about your question about ease of convenience and security. And there's always that balancing act, and I think we're going to have to deal with more complex systems, and we're going to be, it's going to be less convenient for us to work day to day. What a lot of people don't do in companies is, to your second question about, why isn't this data protected, is they don't do a data classification exercise, right, where you have, you need to, in the ideal world, a company would go, here's all my informational assets, and I want to segment that not only from a physical network type segmentation, but I want to understand what that data is, where it's located, who has access to it, right? And then put that into a more protected area of your network. Right? One thing that Ed said, which is one of the reasons why that's so hard, is that now you've instead of having a totally flat system, where you can access all of this, now you've got to go through different vertical layers. And that adds a lot of complexity, and all these different applications, they're not talking to each other. So it's a big, big problem.
As we develop better and better tools to assess threats and
So we're getting to the point now where it's, for most organizations, very reactive, but as technology improves, things will start to learn. And when they start to learn, I don't know if it'll get become quite predictive, but it'll certainly help us.
There's a huge problem with jurisdiction of these things. You call the Newton police on that, they're going to say, well, we don't know who this guy is. Call the FBI. The FBI is not going to work on a $500 case. This just came out today. This is comes out of the CERT team. In late 2014, information technology specialists at a large corporation determined the source of a malware infection on an executive's computer to be an e-cigarette charging on a USB port. Malware had been hard-coded into the e-cigarette charger. It was plugged into the USB port of the executive's computer. The malware infected the executive's computer. They're finding this all over the place now. Manufacturing companies in different countries. There's malware on some of the devices that are being shipped out. So a brand new device that you buy is already infected. So this is how complex this issue is, the emerging threat. The jurisdiction part of it has not been resolved yet. And, sending them $500, the next request is going to be $1,000. So the best thing to do is to buy a new computer, shut the thing down and start over again. But these are the kind of scams that the old Bunko squad would have been following. When it hits the individual like that, it really hurts. I had a very good friend, a detective lieutenant from the state police, who had his information compromised. A guy went out and took a car loan with his information. That was 10 years ago. He's never been able to resolve that. And he had all the resources of the Attorney General's office and the feds and everything else. He's never been able to fix it. So it's a huge personal problem that can affect your personal finance.
There's a few to the personal question you have. What you do personally, download those patches. It's kind of irritating. New operating system comes out, they say update, it's a pain, but it makes a difference because sometimes you get updated because there's vulnerabilities quite often in the older versions. Obviously, having long passwords with capital letters and numbers and exclamation marks is good. There are tools out there like LastPass is what I use. It stores all of your passwords in a more secure way so that you don't have to go to the thing underneath your desk or the file that has all your passwords. And then there's also and Josh makes us do all these things, there's the 4-number security to get into your iPhone. It really feels like a pain, but then you get used to it, pretty quickly. You change that password every 4 weeks or whatever it was, you get used to it.
Can I just have one thing too? On your phone, when you download an app, it's supposedly vetted through, say, the Apple Store. It's not really vetted that well, right? They do a test. So I always imagine I'm going to download a flashlight app, I turn it on, and it's going to have malware. But it's an innocuous app, right? I don't care where it came from. I don't even look where who the author was. I just download it, and it says flashlight app. It's got some good reviews. I think that's another vector, especially these in the mobile.
If you want two excellent examples, one of what the government is doing, and another in the Internet of Things, who has watched the 60 Minutes special this last Sunday evening on DARPA and cybersecurity? It's excellent. Download it and watch it. They talked about a couple of things. The most recent DARPA initiatives on designing new computers for exactly the kind of security you're talking about. And they demonstrate how Leslie Stahl and text hacked into a moving automobile into the computers and turn on the windshield wipers and stop the brakes from running just over the web. So just a couple of things that would be very interesting to watch.
Let's not forget the patch that BMW pushed out on their cars the last couple of weeks.
So sort of in that vein,
legislative standpoint, which was mentioned earlier about the president's executive order on cybersecurity, in this framework document, various proposals that the president put in, there's certain legislatives who try to put laws in place to address at least some of these issues to get us to the point of the club or some of the other examples, like putting out fires before they start. Do you feel that the current legislation that is in Congress now is sufficient for problems that they have hit? And if you were a member of Congress today and had the ability to write laws, what types of laws would you write that would put us in a better position than we are now?
I can tell you, one of the proposals in the president's legislation is to have one national standard for breach notification. Right now, you have 47 different states with different laws around these issues. So I truly wish that the legislature would get around that. Let's do something as a country and have a national standard which is applicable. I would hope that we would start there and then drill down into some more detail. But the fact that we can't get that done in this day and age is maddening to me. And he has proposed it. But what I'm hearing, though, and I have a partner in D.C. through our office, he says he doesn't think, he thinks it's DOA on the Hill. He doesn't think it's going anywhere.
What if they set up the cybersecurity center either in Ohio or Kentucky? We have time for one more question.
The operating systems on all mobile devices are up to speed. So it's a little bit of what I was saying earlier in terms of downloading patches, but putting accountability against that just to make sure good behavior is happening amongst all the people using their mobile devices. So it's almost kind of standard table stakes, good behavior, good discipline, things that more companies do, the less likely they are to get breached.
So we spoke a lot about big corporations and what they do, municipalities and what they can do, and individuals and what they can do. But some of us are small business owners. You know, I got 20 people in my company. I run a kids company, okay, a summer camp. But I still have vital information about, you know, parents, where they live, addresses, phone numbers, and I try to offload credit card data as much as possible. Besides these frameworks that you're talking about, the budgets that you're talking about in terms of spending to cover this stuff far exceeds my annual revenue for 10 years. What advice, if any, do you have for the small business owners who are sort of out there, you know, swimming, trying to get my head around it while I'm still trying to make sure the kids are having a good time?
Just real quick about Jerry mentioned the 201 CMR 17 is, even for small businesses, you have to protect all that information no matter where it is. So it's either encryption, encrypting that data, it's, you know, storing it in a locked cabinet. But yeah, it's really important for small business. I would say that's, you know, there's no different than a large company, really. But obviously your budgets are going to be potentially a lot smaller. I mean, there's lots of, and Josh mentioned it too, which is a lot of these vulnerabilities exist because of people, and making sure that you, the people in your organization, understand, you know, or have a culture of this security mindset makes a big difference. Because, you know, most likely, you know, your organization is not going to be a big target, you know, with the data that you have. And at least the professional needs are probably not going after you. But you never know. There could easily be hacked, or you could fall for a phishing scam and have to pay $500 to get your computer back. But there are definitely some tools for small businesses out there. But it's just keep your network secure, keep your patches, your systems, and just make sure everyone understands what it means to be that be a secure organization.
Yeah, Susie, Don, yourself, and the woman next to you, send me an email. I'm going to say, in the interest of time, I'm going to send you a couple quick and easy things. It'll be two pages, but it'll be helpful to you as far as what's being said that can be done and what the provisions are within Massachusetts that you have to comply with, and we'll get you down as base level.
A lot of those things aren't expensive. It's just going
to... Can you give
through,
us your email address?
Yeah.
There's a bunch of open source stuff. It's free.
It's on the website? Okay. But it's G Leone, L-E-O-N-E, at Nixon Peabody.com.
Don't open it.